As a side effect of the carnivore diet, Dave was able to lose a whopping 30 pounds and show us that he's got some abs. Congratulations. Also, due to the debilitating effects of a stroke at the age of 17, Dave had a pretty impaired right limp, and he also had arthritis in his left knee, which added to the difficulty of his walking. As you can see on the right, after being on carnivore for several months, his walk has improved. Let's hear all about it.
Hey, so Dave Mack, zero carb. I have a lot of gratitude I wanted to express to you for inviting me on your show last time. And I just want to tell you what a wonderful experience that was for me. And I've never done anything like that before. And I mean, other than with family and myself. So I thought it was just totally awesome. And I really appreciate it. And one of the things I wanted to really point out was how much I love your crowd, your subscribers and who were watching the video. The comments were just really hit me right in the heart. And some of the things that were said in the comments, I'd never had said to me before. And I just wanted to give a shout out to all your watchers and listeners, how grateful I am for watching and listening. And there was one person, not sure who it was, but they said something about how they thought that my son might be thinking that he's proud of his dad. And that was the most poignant comment out of all of them. But I told that to my wife, and she started tearing up. And that's a great thought. You know, every father wants to have their children proud of them. But I just want to thank you for that. And as I talked to you a little bit after the podcast, you know, I'd heard one of your stories, your video that I think you did about all the benefits you got from carnivore. And I'm blown away, really, because some of the things you were talking about, like, was it the diabetes? Did you have type 1 or type 2? Or
I was pre-diabetic.
Pre-diabetic. So what, can you explain what pre-diabetic is? I mean, what are the symptoms and what are you actually going through?
It wasn't, there weren't really any symptoms of pre-diabetes. It was just, you know, my A1C was up to about, I think it was about 5.8 or something like that. And the thresholds in Japan are a little bit lower than they are in the US or Australia. So like I think maybe in America, they may, in Australia, they may not take it as seriously till it's about a 6 or something like that. But in Japan, you know, I think above 5.6 here, they're pretty, you know. So I was pre-diabetic, and the only things that I would ever suffer from is I would get, you know, when you get the shakes and you need sugar.
Yeah,
that's it. That's the only thing that ever felt like it was a symptom that could be related to diabetes. Yeah. So other than that, I went in there knowing, oh, well, I eat too much sugar. I know that. But, you know, when the doctor said, this is your number, bah-bah, that was a bit of a shock.
So was that your low point then? Or what was it exactly that happened that made you want to search for carnivore?
So that was part of the low point. So the same day, the doctor also, the doctor also mentioned that, you're drinking too much alcohol, and spoiler alert, I knew that already too. He said, look, we've got to deal with both of these things. This is, if you don't deal with it now, when you come back here in 1 year, 2 years, 3 years time, it's going to be really bad. And so he prioritized the alcohol as the problem. And he wanted to put me on a drug to control or to cut out alcohol. And the drug is called antabuse. What antabuse does is you take it and it's completely doesn't do anything. Yeah. Unless you drink alcohol after taking it. Oh. If you drink alcohol after taking it, you become violently ill and potentially die. And really? So I had a problem with taking what, you know, what's almost like a, you know, a tablet that's going to knock me off the perch. And so I thought, no, I don't like this. I've never been a fan of medication anyway. And so I thought I want to try and do something about this on my own. And having the doctor say, you've got issues again, which I knew I had, but having hearing him say it really made me think, okay, well, I've got to do something about it.
How long had you been drinking before that?
Since I was 15.
Wow.
Yeah. So I started drinking. My introduction to drinking was when I worked at McDonald's part-time while I was in high school. One of the managers had a party one night, invited me to the Saturday night, invited me to the party. I went there. I was a wallflower, you know. I was always had social anxiety, and someone gave me a can of like vodka and orange or something like that, and I noticed that I was loosening up a little bit after a few sips of this vodka and orange, and I think I had two cans, and I earned the nickname Toucan Sam after that. but it really changed my personality. And it allowed me to be more open. It allowed me to be more social and get rid of that anxiety. Okay. And that's why it became a crutch, I think.
So then you're like full blown into alcoholism then for how many years? How do you mind me asking? How old are you?
I'm 49. So there was that period, like, you know, around high school age, and then I kind of stopped drinking because I went to live on my own and I moved away from far away from home and that. So it was like that was my clean, you know. I was starting out on my own for the first time, and I because I was living on my own in Australia, you can't really drink and drive beyond a certain amount, and I was on my probationary license, you can't drink at all. So I just didn't even think about it. But then I traveled overseas and I was working overseas with my company. And when you're working overseas and, you know, you don't have to go home to the drudgery of day-to-day life and whatever, every day's a party. And so then the drinking and you're socializing so much, and that anxiety was still there. And so that's where it took off. So that was from like the age of 20 onwards. So from the age of, say, 20 to about 40, 47.
So your liver was pretty much taking a beating then for a few years.
Right? Yeah, it was. It's the fact that my numbers seem good, you know, it's coped pretty well.
So was it affecting your family? I mean, relationships with close family members with the alcohol and all that, or?
Yeah. It did in a way, like, for example, we would be going out for dinner on the weekend or something. And all I could think of when we're going out for dinner is the alcohol that I'm going to have with the dinner. So my daughter would want to go to a particular kind of kids style of restaurant where they don't serve alcohol or something like that. And I would be like, oh, hang on. Is this the best restaurant we could go to? You know, can we not go somewhere else? You know, so it was kind of like that, you know, like I don't think there was that much in the way of relationship, like very, very direct relationship problems. But yeah, definitely kind of how best to describe it. Yeah, like trying to get to the alcohol any way I could is the thing.
Now, did you have anyone in your family that was or alcoholics? I mean, was there any kind of like maybe genetic predisposition to have that?
Yeah, my father was an alcoholic.
Okay, and what about like his father or any other generations?
I don't know. So his father died very early, so I never met him.
That's what I've heard. I've heard that when the alcoholism is in a family line, your lifespan is right around 50-ish. I mean, have you heard that at all? Or
I hadn't, but yeah. The normal? My father's alcoholism was so bad. He got, I'm going to pronounce this incorrectly, but someone will be able to look it up. It's Wernicke's encephalitis. It's basically where you've had that much alcohol that it's changed the structure of your brain somehow or something like that. So you end up having hallucinations or something like that. I'm not sure exactly, but yeah.
That's pretty intense. So did you try to quit at any time and found it difficult, or did you use like AA or anything like that?
I had bouts of stopping alcohol before, but it's always been short-lived. But it's one of those things that I always thought, I'm young, it's okay, don't worry about it, there's plenty of time to give up. And you know, even I found out about my father's condition with that Wernicke's happened around 2008, I believe, or at least that's when I found out about it, because I was living in Japan. And even at that point, I was like, I said to myself, you should stop drinking. But I was like, oh, it's okay. I'm only, what age would I have been then? You know, 37, 38, something like that. It's okay. You know, don't worry about it. There's plenty of time. And of course, you know, it's like anything. There's plenty of time until there's not.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So was it that point when you're with your doctor and he said, you really need to get a handle on this? Is that when you started looking for something to help out with that? Or what was the process?
So he wanted to put me on this antabuse, and I thought, nah, I don't want to do it. So I decided to, I knew that I needed to get some self-control. And I knew that when I'd been on keto diets in the past, I'd had a lot more self-control. Because those times, I had been able to reduce my alcohol intake. I had been able to give up the sugar, and so on and so forth. So I said to the doctor, look, give me a few weeks to try and sort this out on my own first. And so from that day, I went keto. And I gave up the alcohol cold turkey. I gave up the sugar cold turkey. I was fully keto. And that just kind of quickly transitioned into carnivore.
Because that's pretty hard to give anything up like that, especially alcohol and sugar at the same time. Did you have any like withdrawal symptoms or like intense cravings while you're doing that?
I had cravings. Yeah. I'm not sure if the withdrawal symptoms or not, or it was something to do with diet or whatever, but I was very, very moody.
Yeah. That's quite a transition.
Yeah. But my personality is kind of all or nothing. And so there's no kind of just just gradually reduce the amount of alcohol you're drinking, or just gradually reduce the amount of sugar you're drinking. I'm either a carb addict or I'm not. I'm either an alcoholic or I'm not. I'm either a smoker or I'm not, you know?
Yeah, I've heard that analogy where some people look at it as a dial or a knob. I think Dr. Ken Berry was mentioning it was a dial. And you just kind of slowly turn the carbs off, or else it's a switch. Someone else was talking about it being just you flip a switch and it's either all or nothing. But that's quite amazing. Now, did you have a stroke as well, or what was with your walk? You had, and it affected your walk and your balance. I saw the comparison when you were walking side by side. That was before and after. That was incredible.
Yeah. So, this goes back a long way. So, I did have a stroke, in 1992.
Wow.
So, that was when I was 17.
Wow.
So, I was working full time at the time as an IT assistant. And you know, even though I was only 17, I was already working full time. And on Sunday night, I went to bed early, you know, 10 o'clock or 10:30 or something, getting ready, you know, for the next day, because I had to get up early to travel a long way to go to work. Went to bed, and next day I woke up and I'm like, oh, I feel like I've got hangover or something, or is this a virus? What's going on? And my body felt kind of different down one side, and when I tried to get out of bed, I couldn't stand up properly, and it was all very weird. And you know, to be honest, a lot of it I can't really remember, but I kind of shook it off as, oh, it's just a virus, it's all right. And at that point, you know, before, you know, the last few years of COVID, you know, if you had a virus, you just soldiered on, you know. It wasn't like, you know, you've got a virus, you got to quarantine for a million years until, you know. And so I was just like, I'm going to soldier on, you know. And I'm 17 years old. So I got up, got ready for work, and you know, went to the office. Going to the office required a one-hour train trip. And by the time I got to the office, I was limping pretty badly. And I'm walking into the office and like I was banging into stuff as I was walking. And I thought, oh, this is not a virus.
And it was just your left side? Was that?
My right side.
Well, the right side. Right side.
So, but that was kind of affecting the coordination everywhere, you know? It was the right side that was affected, and I didn't realize it at this point, but of course the right side of my face was starting to droop more, and I wasn't intelligible when I was talking. And so I just thought, nah, this is something's wrong. So I just got straight back on the train and went home. And so another hour to get home. And like by the time I got home and I was walking back to the house, I was dragging my leg behind me.
Oh, wow.
And my mum met me outside and she's like, what is going on? And she drove me to the doctor, and you know, there was lots of drama that happened along the way. But long story short, I had a subarachnoid hemorrhage while I was sleeping, so aneurysm on the basilar artery, just like a blowout in a tire, it burst while I was sleeping, and I was just lucky it clotted very quickly.
Wow. And so you're on the keto to help with your alcoholism. And then How long were you on it before you actually noticed an improvement with your walking?
So I noticed, I mean, it had transitioned to carnivore before I noticed anything. So, I mean, I was keto kind of for about 2 or 3 weeks. And then it went to carnivore. And
why was that?
Vegetables were keeping me in the bathroom.
Did you hear something about carnivore and just wanted to upgrade the level there, or is that?
It was just the vegetables I was eating on keto. Sorry. Let me step back a minute. So it is to do with vegetables, but basically, I was finding that suddenly, now that I was on keto, I was feeling better and blah blah blah, but I was in the bathroom more than I wanted to be. And I was like, hang on, this doesn't feel right. This never happened to me before on keto. So I'm going to try and work out what this is. So I'm on YouTube searching around, and I found a video by Ken Berry, and it was talking about how vegetables, you know, are not necessarily the best for you. And
who would have thought?
He particularly singled out some vegetables that caused gastrointestinal problems that were the vegetables I was eating.
Oh, wow.
And so I just thought, you know what? I'll just try giving them away. So I gave them away and I felt better. Everything improved. And of course, then YouTube started recommending more and more carnivore content to me.
Right.
And so it was just every day I was watching hours of carnivore content. Yeah. And going, okay, so this thing that I've fallen into, it's a thing. And yeah.
So then you're into the carnivore, and then how long did it take for it to start, for your benefits to start showing up? I mean, how soon did you start noticing benefits?
Sure. So almost immediately there's improvements with sleep and clarity and focus and stuff like that. And I'm not sure whether that's, you know, related to actually eating meat, or that's just getting junk food out of your diet. I think it's probably more related to getting junk food.
Like combination of both, yeah.
But you know, the about 2 or 3 months in, I no longer had arthritis in my left knee.
Really?
My limp on the right side had improved. So you can imagine, before I had arthritis in my left knee, I was limping with my right leg.
Yeah.
It was comical watching me walk up and down the street, you know, if I could.
That's rough.
And one day I realized that it had happened. I had to run across an intersection because the lights were changing, and otherwise I wouldn't have run because of my knee. And when I started to run, and my body had this kind of visceral reaction, like, stop, don't, this is going to hurt. And but I had to keep going because the lights were changing. And then I was like, oh, it doesn't hurt anymore. What's that about? And
great feeling.
Then it's, of course, then I'm testing it, you know? And yeah, that was awesome. So most things I noticed about 2 or 3 months in.
2 or 3 months. And how long had you had the arthritis in your knee?
That was about a year and a half.
Prior, yeah.
Yeah.
Because, I noticed that too with the joint pain. My goodness. It's just not there. And what a fantastic benefit. Because, yeah, I talked to several people, you know, my neighbors and some friends that have joint pain a lot. And, I mean, who would have thought that just the simple dietary change could affect your joints like that? It's just incredible,
right? Amazing. Yeah, I mean, it's indescribable. It's hard to put into words how life-changing it is to be able to bend over, to tie your shoes, to sit cross-legged, to kneel down on the floor. It's crazy.
So how did you're on carnivore for a little while, and I know I asked you this before, but when we weren't recording, but I was wondering about the actual alcohol cravings. You said you just quit cold turkey. You didn't really have any withdrawal symptoms, but as you go down the road, month, 2 months, 3 months, does it become just easier to shy away from the alcohol, or did you just have that extra willpower, or how did that feel?
Well, one, it's kind of two, maybe three parts. The first thing was just having that extra self-control because, you know, I was on carnivore and I was able to just carnivore gives you that elevated feeling of being able to just kind of, it's like a carnivore calm, you know? So there's that. The second thing is that I changed things so that I didn't face triggers for the first month or two. So every day at work, I'd be in my last hour or two of the day and I'd be like thinking, oh, this class is a nightmare. This is going badly. It's okay. Just think about the beer you can have on the train on the way home. And then, of course, I'd be walking back to the train station and I'd pass the convenience store and I'd go in there and buy a beer. So what I had to do to avoid triggers like that is I had to, you know, change the way I was thinking about if I was having a bad day, and also kind of go the long way around when I was going home so I didn't walk past that convenience store. So I wasn't faced with the triggers in the first place. So the self-control... I could exercise self-control beforehand rather than having to exercise the self-control at the moment where the trigger's in front of me, which is going to make me a lot weaker. And that helped. And the other thing was I just said to friends, look, please, you know, no offense, but please don't invite me around for parties or invite me out or whatever for the next couple of months, because I'm... You know, if I'm at your house and everyone's having a drink, I'm just going to drink, you know, because I won't be able to help myself. So, you know, and friends were quite accommodating with that. And, you know, I've had one friend that was even like, let's, you know, if you want to meet at a bar and we can sit and have non-alcohol beer together or whatever, you know.
That's incredible. You mentioned that carnivore calm. So it affects your brain and your mood as well. Can you elaborate a little on that?
I'm probably going to forget some things, but there's a lot of stuff that I could kind of put into that carnivore calm thing. And I mean, probably maybe it's the best way I could describe it is this, like, If you think of like normal day-to-day life, anything in day-to-day life is like a rugby scrum. Do you know rugby scrum? Mm-hmm.
Yes, yeah. Sir.
So rugby scrum, right?
A little bit less than gridiron.
Yeah. It's all busy and everyone's, you know, but carnivore calm is, you know, you're able to kind of rise above that scrum and kind of assess what's going on. And it's like, I kind of look at it as, you know, taking a more objective kind of view of everything, or, you know, not being fazed by anything, or it manifests itself a lot in the workplace, I think, you know, because like what I've noticed is things where I would get really frustrated before, or really fight back about things before, is where, you know, we'd be talking about a project and someone would be saying, let's do it this way. And I would be like, no, this way is the best. My way is the best, blah, blah, blah. And now I'm more able to kind of step back and go, who cares? Doesn't matter in the grand scheme of things. If we do it his way or her way, what does it matter? You know, how's it going to affect my life in 10 years from now?
You know, that's an amazing perspective. like going back when you said you were a kid, when you're 15, 17, and you turn to the alcohol to relieve your social anxiety, does being on carnivore and giving you that carnivore calm, is that a similar effect, or is it a little different? I know it doesn't have the side effects, but
in terms of anxiety,
yeah, does it alleviate your anxiety now with carnivore?
To a degree, yeah. I mean, I still have some social anxiety, but it has, excuse me. So, to a degree, it does. I'm more confident than I've ever been.
Confidence.
But I feel like, yeah, I still have some social anxiety, which people might think is a bit weird because considering I'm making videos every day, I'm a public speaking trainer and things like that.
Fantastic.
But I think, you know, public speaking or making YouTube videos and things like that is a little bit different than being in a social situation where you just got to randomly go and talk to people.
Right.
You know, and like my personality is kind of, I could be on stage in front of 500 people and I could talk, I can make them laugh and stuff like that. But then if I've got to go and talk to each of them individually afterwards, that's where it's going to be tough for me.
Huh. Well, much better medium than to get rid of that than alcohol, I'd say. There's the subject of addiction too, which is, you know, it's just so prevalent in our society. And have you ever interviewed anyone else that's been able to have like success with addictions with carnivore?
I guess everyone I interview probably, you know, they were addicted to sugar at least. So yes,
most people don't consider that too bad.
Yeah, but other addictions?
I mean, like cigarettes, alcohol, drugs.
Cigarettes, no, alcohol, yeah. I've spoken to some people that have overcome alcohol addiction.
Well, sugar's a big, I mean, sugar's a drug too. I mean, just look what it does to the brain. In your interviews with people, what kind of insights have you heard about when people start carnivore as far as their sugar addiction's concerned? Did they cut cold turkey, a lot of them, or they kind of gradually wean off the carbs, or what have you noticed?
So from the people I've spoken to, I would say, and this is not a rule, this is definitely not a rule, but it does feel to me that a lot of people that that do quite well with carnivore as far as sticking with it the first time seem to be people that have gone cold turkey. And I know that that's probably not the best way to do it because you're upsetting everything.
Yeah.
About, you know, your microbiome and everything. You're shocking your whole body. But it does seem to be a theme. It's like, you know, people just saying, yeah, I went cold turkey. I was actually thinking about putting a video together with a lot of people saying that, you know, no. It's just one after the other. And I guess that's probably personality related, but I wonder also if people who have a more all or nothing mentality are naturally more drawn to a solution like carnivore in the first place.
Wow. Yeah, that's quite an addiction to come over. I was like that too. It was just like a switch for me. Because I don't really care about taste, and you know, I'd have sweets very, very rarely, but I think the vegetables were the biggest benefit for me once I got rid of all the veggies and just went straight beef. That's when I noticed the biggest, biggest difference. But the other thing, I think people, when they hear or see carnivore or keto, they think it's just a weight loss diet. But it's, as you know, it's so much more than that. I mean, it's a healing diet.
Yeah.
It just balances the body. But did you, you had some weight loss as well. I saw a before and after picture you had on there. How was your experience there?
Yeah. So I dropped about 34 pounds, which is about 15 kilos. But I mean, here's something that is definitely a theme from all the people I've interviewed, and myself included. Weight loss is great, and a lot of people start for weight loss, but weight loss becomes secondary to every other health benefit that comes with being on carnivore.
It's like a side effect.
Hmm.
Well, what would you say to anyone who's maybe listening to this and is concerned with the cholesterol? I mean, I know I've heard Dr. Barry's explanation, Anthony Chaffee's explanation, but especially people who are a little older, they're kind of, you know, they've listened to what their doctors told them for decades and decades. And I think there's a legitimate fear out there that people are just like, whoa, well, you know, my doctor says I can't do this, which is crazy. Mm. But what's your take and what you've found from interviewing people as far as their cholesterol is concerned?
Well, some people's cholesterol is going to normalize with this diet. Some people's cholesterol will go up, and it seems to be the leaner you are, the higher your cholesterol is going to go.
Hmm.
But the thing really is the idea of cholesterol being responsible for heart disease is, it's just at best, it's a guess.
Yeah.
Because no one can actually prove anything. And, you know, one of the books that I've been reading lately is a book by Malcolm Kendrick, and it's called The Clot Thickens. And one of the things that he mentions in there is that when the atherosclerotic plaques have been checked after someone has died, and they've examined like what makes up the plaque, and they find LDL in the plaque, it's not necessarily LDL. It's like, I can't remember the name exactly, but it's like LDL, and I think it might be LP little a or something like that. So it's not actually, so it's like LDL, but it's not 100% LDL, right? Mm-hmm. And so, but for the people doing it, they're looking to pin the blame on LDL.
Yeah.
And so it's like, oh, LDL's here. Okay, job done. And we know what caused it. And so there are these kind of things. But also, I think if people look at the research, they'll find that, you know, of the people that die of heart attacks, my understanding is a lot of the people that die of heart attacks have low cholesterol. And so, I mean, that doesn't really line with what we're being told.
Yeah. Yeah. That's,
but I'm not a doctor. So, you know, take that as that. That's a 100% layman's opinion.
And then, but your brain needs cholesterol to make your hormones out of at the same time.
Well, that's right. It. And think about this. Right, like your brain needs cholesterol for the cells to communicate with each other. Like one cell communicates with another cell through the cholesterol, is what I've heard. Right, so imagine if you're starving yourself of cholesterol, what might you be setting yourself up for in later life?
Yeah, ADHD, autism,
potentially, and potentially dementia.
Dementia. Aren't they calling, they're even calling that, what, diabetes type 3?
Right.
Dementia. Yeah. That's just so related.
And yeah.
what I'm blown away is by the amount of mental illness there is, you know, not only in the States, but, you know, it's a worldwide epidemic. Mm-hmm. And if you look back at how they were, you know, in the early 60s, 70s, eggs are bad. Don't eat the eggs. Don't eat the beef. Don't eat the fat. I mean, we're just cutting out all these essential brain nutrients and the fat from our diets. And as a society, we, you know, we're really paying the price in these latter years. But
yeah. And, you know, as the generations go on, and there's more ultra-processed foods available to us, and people are eating less meat, it's not getting better, it's getting worse. And, you know, so there are some trend lines there, and it's not that red meat consumption is going up.
Right. Mm. Now, I heard, I saw you're on another channel talking about how someone was blind. And
yes.
They got their sight started coming back. Now, were they diabetic as well, or how did that
come I'm not sure he was diabetic. I honestly can't remember that detail. But I'd have to go. It's quite a few months ago, so I can't remember the exact details. But yeah, he was legally blind, and he started eating this way, and he noticed that suddenly he could make out the colors in his iPhone more than he had been able to before. Wow. And you know, the picture was looking clearer. And then he was out walking the dog with his daughter one day, and he realized, first time he'd seen her face in 10 years.
Oh, wow. And how long had he been on carnivore before he started noticing things like that?
I have to go and check. I can't remember the details. So, but it was probably a few months.
So not too.
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't years. Yeah, it was a period of months, I think.
That's pretty amazing. Just a couple of months, it has that kind of change. Hmm. As a veteran, I'm very disturbed and shaken by the amount of veterans that are taking their own lives. For instance, in the last 20 years, I think we lost about 7,000 soldiers in the conflicts in 20 years. Mm. But they don't tell you that the amount of suicides that we've lost is 100,000. In the last 20
That's
years.
That's crazy.
100,000. And I just hope and pray that, you know, people like yourself and everyone else that's out there doing channels can put the message out or send their videos to a veteran who's had some hard times. And I think the number was 22 a day. There was about on the average was 22 suicides
Wow.
a day. And it I think it's gone down a little bit, but you know, that just hits home to me. And I just want to put that message out there that anybody who knows a veteran who's struggling, I mean, I truly believe that a carnivore diet can help, just like you're talking about the mental health aspects. It gives you that carnivore calm. It's a mental calmness. And I know a lot of these veterans that are, they're combat veterans, they, you know, with the PTSD and everything, it's very disturbing. And the diet, I mean, the SAD diet, standard American diet, is completely contributing to all of those symptoms. And I know it's helped me and it's helped you. And I just pray that, you know, anyone watching this can share the video with a veteran, and let's help get that number. It should be zero a day. But I'm so grateful to see people like yourself out there, because you truly believe, you're passionate as far as what it's done for you. I mean, do you feel that? I can feel the care that you have for other people. It's incredible. But Can you explain how that's changed you once you got the benefits and now you want to help others and you've got this YouTube channel?
What it was for me, one of my guests actually put it very well the other day. Her experience was the same as mine. I fell into carnivore. Wasn't planning on doing anything. I didn't start a channel until I was 3 or 4 months in. And so when I started the channel, it wasn't because I wanted to document my journey. It was because I was angry. Because I just feel like we've been lied to.
Yeah.
And so that's what it's all about for me. You know, it's just like, you know, maybe it doesn't work for everyone, but maybe, you know, maybe you're not, everyone's not going to get exactly the same benefits, but from all the people I've spoken to, which is well over 200 at this point, they all everyone's got their own unique story, but everyone reports the same kinds of improvements. You know, some people might say it's not 100% gone, but it's 85% of the way there, you know. And there's no other diet like that. There's no other diet out there that's going to, you know, no one's out there going, I reduced my calories and moved more, and now I'm feeling fantastic.
Right.
No one's doing that.
Did you have any medications that you were taking before that you're able to get off of or anything like that?
No, I wasn't taking anything. Yeah.
No meds.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, you were almost to take that, to make you sick when you drink alcohol.
So exactly. So that was the, like, I was just like, no. When I was a kid, I was on hay fever medication for years that never actually had any beneficial effects. And so I've just, from that being a kid, I've always been skeptical about meds. And so I avoid them where I can.
Yeah, that's a great quality to have. I mean, mentally you're thinking, I don't want anything to do with this. I don't want to have it. I've noticed that in a lot of the stories with people who find carnivore, they have that little bit of, I don't know, animosity towards medications because they know where they can lead and everything with the side effects, but they decide to take their health into their own hands. And I mean, have you seen that? I mean, people, they get angry, they get frustrated with the regular medical establishment, and now they have something that they can do themselves and take care of their, you know, take responsibility for their own health. I think that's very empowering.
Yeah.
Don't you?
I definitely. And I wish I could remember who had heard this quote from. It was another carnivore, but the ultimate act of defiance is taking your health into your own hands.
Oh, that's a great quote. Mm. Yeah. Wow. Well, incredible. Anything else you want to add about your benefits? I mean, maybe I'm missing something about your...
Look, I would just like to say to anyone out there that hasn't started, that may be thinking of giving it a try, I think the best way to do it is not to start and think, oh, I'm going to have to do this for 50 years. How am I going to eat steak for 50 years? My life is going to be boring. I can't do this. And I would say, don't look at it that way. Change the way you're looking at it when you're first getting started and just look at it on a day-to-day basis. So in day one, all you want to focus on is not how many years you're going to be doing this. Don't think about that. Just focus on getting through day one without cheating. Just get into bed on the evening of day one with having nothing but steak, eggs, bacon, etc. And then, you know, what's going to happen is you wake up day two. And the first thing that you're going to think when you wake up on day two is, I did it. I went through the whole of day one without cheating. Awesome. So what's going to happen is your resolve is a bit stronger now. And so it's going to be easier to get through day two, but still just focus on day two, getting to bed without cheating. And your resolve's a little bit stronger. Day three, same thing happens again. You know, it's like, oh, I did it again. I'm feeling better as well. I slept better. That's great. Okay. I don't want to stop that happening. And so, you know, it just builds on itself. And then before long, it's like, I don't care if it's 50 years, you know, I'm enjoying this.
Snowball effect.
Yeah.
Well, I was also going to ask you what you eat in a day.
Oh, okay. So typically one meal a day. And that's breakfast time, 7 a.m. and later on the weekends. But about a pound of ground beef. And the number of eggs was 10, but it varies between six to 10 eggs, depending on how I'm feeling.
That's pretty good chunk.
Yeah. And so, I mean, it takes a long time to get that down, but like, and salt on that, there's nothing else. Like, I don't even use tallow or lard or whatever. I don't do that anymore. All I do is like throw the ground beef into a pan, cook up the ground beef, take that out and put it in a bowl. And then with the rendered fat that's left, that's what I cook the eggs in.
And that's so simple.
Yeah.
Simplified.
Yeah. And no waste, you know, very little waste. That's one of the things that often amuses me about, people that are saying, you know, we have to go plant-based for the environment. When you look at the plant-based stuff they're eating, there's so much waste from there. I mean, how's that good for the environment?
Yeah. I kind of get a kick out of the debates. What was it? Dr. Sean Baker had a couple of vegetarians on his channel. Did you see that video? And they were
I didn't see that one. I've heard of it, but I didn't see that
they
one.
They were arguing back and forth and it was quite comical, but it's so important. I mean, in the fitness world, we usually say that, you know, 85% of your success is what goes in your mouth. I mean, of course, the workouts are beneficial, but you can't ever out-exercise a bad diet. And, you know, lifestyle is the same way. I don't think you can have a healthy lifestyle if your diet's not on point. And, oh, my wife asked me the other day, she's like, do you ever miss vegetables? And I was like, what? Miss what? I hadn't even thought about it. Because it's so satisfying, too, just to have the fat and the protein and eggs. That's the essential part of mine as well. But I wasn't even missing vegetables. But I was wondering, do you ever get sick of eating the same thing?
Never. I look forward to it each day.
Yeah. So do I.
I mean, I get sick of it once my body is sending me a signal, you've eaten enough now.
Oh, okay.
Right. But like when the next day when I wake up and I'm making breakfast, it's like, oh, I can't wait for this.
Oh, also I was going to ask you about you said you use salt, but do you use a special kind of salt or do you have to supplement with any extra electrolytes or how do you get enough of those?
I don't take electrolytes, but I use pink, like Himalayan salt.
Himalayan, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's my favorite. Have you noticed that your body needs more salt on this diet?
Well, I feel like I want to have more salt, but yeah. I'm not sure if that's, well, I always liked salt, but yeah. I'm not sure whether that's because my body needs it or because I feel like, you know, now that I'm on carnivore, I have the green light to have it. So yeah. I'm not sure.
Because I'm the same way. I mean, I think I've always been my dad used to call me a saltaholic when I was a kid because, you know, I put salt on everything. But I found since I since I started carnivore, I just need even more salt. And I use a lot as it is, but the pink Himalayan, I just love. And the Redmond's salt, the Redmond salt mine is like a couple hours from my house. It's down here in southern Utah. So you hear a lot about the Redmond salt and you get that at the grocery store. But yeah, pink Himalayan, love it. But always salt everything. And yeah, I just noticed that I my body is needing more salt. I was just wondering if I was the only one or if there was others, but
yeah. I think, you know, there's definitely a part of it anyway that is my body wants the salt. But yeah, I think I'd probably go overboard because I've had the green light.
That's probably a healthy craving, healthy addiction.
Yeah.
Okay, well, Dave, we're getting about up to an hour time. So I just want to thank you again. Really appreciate you giving me your time here and sharing some insights and for being on my tiny little channel. And super appreciative of your knowledge and wisdom and your care for others. It really shows. And just wanted to wish you all the best. And I guess we'll see you out there in YouTube land again.
Thank you so much for having me on, Max. I really appreciate it.
All right. Take care now. We'll see you.
Cheers.
What's up? What's up, warriors? Hey, thanks for listening to the podcast today. Just wanted to thank Dave from Zero Carb. Please check out his channel on YouTube. He's got over 200 interviews with people from all walks of life and all around the world and how they transformed their lives through the carnivore diet. So check out his channel. It's at Zero Carb on YouTube. And also, we are looking for anyone who has a story about their carnivore conversion. If you've had an experience where you've used carnivore diet to overcome any kind of illness or met a challenge in your life, then please give us an email. You can reach us at maximumwarrior1111@gmail.com. Hey, hope to hear from you soon. Max Warrior out.